Now, this is human anatomy. As an industrial hygienist, yes, we have to understand the human anatomy of the human body functions. Yes, it is very important. Unless until we don't understand the anatomy of human body, we cannot recognize how these chemicals, how these particulates are health hazards, which is going to affect our body functions or our functions in not only immediate but also chronic. There are two different health effects we will see, but how those chemicals interfere with our activity, how those chemicals can cause issues physically, mentally also, which is very important. So that is why the anatomy of human body is very important, which we need to understand what is the function of brain and how this brain will get affected and what are the chemicals can affect this brain. And similarly, liver, which is another very, very important part of human body, which is getting affected because of various types of chemicals which the industry is handling. Similarly, the kidneys, intestines, lungs, heart. So we know very well what are the anatomy in the human body. What's important is to understand its functions, which is very important. And by understanding these functions and understanding the toxicity of various types of chemicals, we need to correlate and we can understand how these chemicals will affect our human body system. Maybe we are having, as our enlightened brother told, this presentation we have in our portal also, which is of a very minimum fees. You can enter and you can see some of the slides which is giving more detailed information with regards to human anatomy also. Now, list of systems of the human body: circulatory systems, digestive systems, endocrine system, immune system, integumentary system, that is like nails, skin and all, lymphatic system, musculoskeletal system, nervous system, reproductive system, respiratory system, urinary system. So these are all list of these are all the list of systems in the human body. All these systems is functioning, which we need to understand. And once we are understanding the functions of this human body systems, we will correlate as we discussed in the previous slide. Now we are in another important slide, that is called concept of dose. No substance is a poison by itself. It is a dose that makes a substance a poison. What does it mean? You would have heard of this thing in your childhood also. You know that the honey, even honey is very useful, which is very important source, which is giving immense amount of vitamins, and it is giving a very important source for these things to our body. But however, if you consume more than the adequate amount of honey, or with more than the TLV of honey for a long period of time, even the honey, or if you are consuming a huge amount of this product in same time, which can cause health effects. That is what we need to understand. Anything which is going more than its limit or ideal health, or more than its ceiling limit, it is going to cause some amount of health effects to the human body. So that is why no substance is a poison by itself. It is a dose that makes a substance a poison, because there are some dose which you are going to use in the medical industry to treat the things. And the same drugs, if it goes in more than high amount, more than allowable limit, which is going to cause some amount of health hazard. So that is what we need to understand, what is the concept of dose. Another important item is, what is dose? It is a concentration into duration of exposure. Concentration we know very well, that is what is it is a quantity, what amount of, whether it is a milligram or a kilogram or liters or what, there is a concentration. And the duration of the exposure, the period, the frequency, or and also how much amount of time you are going to spend in those atmosphere, because of spending those period of time and those concentrations, it is going to make the dose serious. So the dose is equal to concentration into duration of exposure. And effects, any observable biological change associated with the contaminated concern. It is quantifiable as well as does not need to cause an adverse observable effects. So any effect, any means because of exposing, getting exposed to those chemicals more than the allowable limit, which this is going to cause some amount of effect. These effects can be immediate or these effects can be chronic. Sometimes these effects can be noticeable and sometimes you may not notice the effects at all. So it is again a very detailed subject. We'll give you some glimpse of information in coming slides. That is a dose and the response curve. Why it is important is the dose and the response curve? This is the correlation between the effects in your organs as well as the amount of dose consumed or taken or getting exposed. When the person is getting exposed to certain amount of exposure, that exposure is going to cause some amount of effect after the TLV reaches, that is the threshold limit value. These noticeable effects after the threshold limit value or unnoticeable effects means that is going to cause some effects in your body, and these effects can go into some extension based on the characteristics of the chemicals up to death as well, or the functional issues, or which can cause some kind of issues in the body temporarily or permanently. So that is why the dose and response curve is also basic information which you need to understand as an industrial hygienist. As we discussed in the previous slide, acute effect means an immediate effect. For example, you are getting exposed to some chemical more than its TLV value, that is called threshold limit value. For example, threshold limit value for any chemical you can expose for eight working hours. Example for HDS, we used to consider HDS as an example for people who is working in oil and gas industry. They can easily understand this concept. For this, I am taking this example. Hydrogen sulfide, it is a gas which people used to encounter in oil and gas industry. So its TLV value is 10 ppm, where the people can work in this atmosphere for continuous 8 hours, where no effects to the body or any no health effects, adverse health effects can take place. But beyond the idealized limit or immediate exposure to a very huge amount of exposure of HDS, for example, 1000 ppm and above. So exposure to those amount of ppm can cause immediate health effects. So that is called acute. Whereas some chemicals, based on your continuous exposure to those chemicals, like benzene and asbestos, why we are considering asbestos? Because the health effects from asbestos, we will come to know only after many years, like 20 to 25 years will take to understand the health effects because of asbestos. So similarly, there are some chemicals where the health effects are noticeable after some time, or the effects even noticeable at the initial period itself, but the cause, the CRD will happen after a period of time, like a month or a year. So the effects should take place more than a day, more than a week, more than a year, called chronic effects. And local effects occur at a point of contact. Any effect which is taking place at the point of contact, for example, if the person is working in some chemical industry and he is touching some chemicals, or he is in contact with any other hot environment or different kinds of atmosphere or health hazards. So the effects happen where the person be in contact with those health hazards. That is called local effect. And systematic effect, which is a very, very important subject, because when we told you about the particulate as a form of dust and even some gases, vapor and all, which is exposed, which the employees are exposing into a different working environment, even it is entering through the inhalation, means through the nose, but the effects are taking place in any part of the body based on its characteristics. So the systematic effect, in the sense, the entry is from inhalation or ingestion or any part of body, means there are four types of route of entry, we will see in coming slide, but the effect is taking place in some other part of the body. maybe in the bone marrow, which is generating RNA and which is generating white blood cells and which is supporting for the blood generation and all. So it can affect any part of the body. So that is called systematic effect. As discussed in the previous slide, the routes of entry are, the routes of entry can be inhalation or skin absorption, ingestion, or even through eye as well. So inhalation, by far most common route of entry is inhalation. Through the people when they are working in, example, near to that welding activities, they exposed to this welding fumes, and welding fumes contains various types of chemicals like chromium and magnesium, different kinds of chemicals based on the electrode. So those fumes are entering into the system or body through inhalation, and the people who is working in the wood industry, where the wood industry is generating different types of dust materials from the wood, and similarly people working in some chemical industries, the gases and vapors, because of the process, those gases and vapors are entering into the body system through inhalation. So inhalation is the most important route of entry for the human body. Then ingestion, relatively minor route of accidental ingestion or poor personal hygiene. For example, person working in a different atmosphere without proper hygiene, without proper rest shelters, or without proper measures, people work in a painting area and they will come and take food immediately. People working in the sand casting area, they will come and take food immediately, or they will start mingling with others, and they will shake hand with others, with the result that other people also can get affected, and it can enter through their ingestion part. So this is another route of entry in the human body system. Skin absorption, some chemicals can enter through direct contact, example organic solvents and pesticides, which can enter through the skin, as well as some can enter through the eye, but which is very minimal. So this is the routes of entry which we should understand as an industrial hygienist. The reason why we are giving the basic concepts of this topic here is, as there are some freshers in this session, as we told in the beginning of the session, you need to understand the concepts. Unless until we don't understand the concepts or the basics of industrial hygienist, there is no point that we are searching for the opportunities with regards to industrial hygienist as well. So that is the reason we have choose some part of subject to give you in this presentation itself. Now we are moving to the next important section, is the target organ. As this is connected to the previous slide, we discussed about the systematic effects and routes of entry. So the routes of entry can be inhalation or eye or through the skin, but it can affect any part of your body. For example, carbon monoxide, which is entering into the through the inhalation, which can irritate in the respiratory system, as well as it is a toxic gas which can become a carboxy hemoglobin when interface with your blood, and can cause other health effects, since like a CNS effects can happen because of this carbon monoxide. Even it is entering through your inhalation, but it can affect your CNS, central nervous systems, and other systems as well as in the body. Similarly, lead and mercury, which can enter in a different part through the entry, but it will affect the blood in the body system. Like toluene, toluene is one of the chemicals people use in the organizations when they are performing different kinds of activities. It can enter through the inhalation, but it can affect central nervous system as well. Similarly, alcohol can affect the liver, and there are many which we couldn't cover in this small brief. This is just a glimpse of information. There are many chemicals which we will discuss in our detailed session programs. We request also the people who are interested to enter into this field, you can utilize the NITM to understand, to study many courses which is already in the portal. You can subscribe to this courses, you can understand more details with regards to this target organs, different kinds of chemicals, what is its characteristics, how it is affecting the system of the body, because this subject, this industrial hygiene subject, it is applicable to almost all types of industry. So it is very useful subject, even if you are not becoming an industrial engineer, knowing this knowledge is not going to go waste. It is going to help you somewhere. Now we are going to that another information, that is called hazard information. This hazard information, in the sense how we will understand those hazards, like we talked about various types of chemicals. So how we will understand the health effect from these chemicals, we can understand from the FDS, usually the manufacturer or the distributor, he will provide the safety data sheet along with the chemical. This safety data sheet, the person can review and understand what is the chemical characteristics, how these chemicals can affect the body system, and what is its TLV, what is LD50, what is LD100. There are various concepts which you can understand through the safety data sheet, and you can apply the precautionary measure according to the safety data sheet also. And there is a GHS, that is called a global harmonized system, which is a general system which is applicable for throughout the world, because it is a global harmonized system developed by like ILO type of systems, which is applicable. This system is developed to have a better understanding between different countries and different organizations. So it's a detailed concept. I am not going to go in detail because we have a separate session with regards to GHS itself. So we will discuss in more detail about GHS in those sessions. And then there is a brainstorming and through walkthroughs, by interviewing the workers, by reading the process. So all these things can help to understand the hazards in the working environment or in the organization. And this is another subject to understand, that is called workplace sampling and monitoring. How these hazards can be assessed or evaluated or measured, there are various scales or various techniques to measure, to read, to understand, to identify the different types of chemicals being exposed in the organization. So that is called air sampling, personal sampling or monitoring, confined spaces. In confined spaces, we will do gas testing, how to do gas test, what all the types of gas can exist in those confined spaces, the health effect from the confined space. This is a separate topic. Then biological monitoring, noise monitoring, how much of noise the person can get exposed, what is the allowable limit as per the local regulation or international regulation, what is your procedure and plan space within your organization, what is the allowable limit as per ECGIH, and whether the people are getting exposed more than this allowable limit or within the limit, or if they are exposing more than the allowable limit, what we should do, or how we can reduce those health effects, what are the additional control measures we can implement so that we can reduce those health effects from the noise, because noise is also very important. We can say noise, it seems like a simple, but from the noise exposure, it can cause various types of health effects in the body. It can change the total harmony of your body system, which even it can cause diabetes, it can cause different types of health effects, stress. So it is very detailed study. The people can understand once they are undergoing those detailed courses. For information, there are some organizations, they are recruiting people as a noise technician also. If people need to work in Malaysia and all, they have a noise technician. You need to certify so that you can work as a noise technician. His only responsibility is to measure the noise exposures in the various organizations, and how this noise is affecting their organization, and what are the control measures to be taken. So, like again, ergonomic study, there are positions in different organizations, ergonomic. So to become ergonomist, the people need to understand more about the ergonomic. They have to become expertise. We cannot become expertise in this field. As we said, it is very detailed, very large. So at least we, as an industrial hygienist, we can understand some concepts and apply those concepts in the organization, and reduce those health effects by applying various kinds of control measures. Then thermal comfort, radiation dose measurement. So there are different and types of sampling and monitoring programs need to be developed, need to be programmed, need to be executed, so that those programs can be effectively implemented to ensure those implementations or taking part in your organization to reduce the health effects. These are some of the workplace monitoring equipment. What we are showing here, like you can see noise monitoring device, you can see vibration monitoring devices, you can see flame patches. The flame patches are being used for the people who is working in radiography related activities. So, and we have other equipment called this for particulate measurement. So pumps and all. So this pumps can be utilized for workplace measurement for gases, for different types of chemicals, for different types of particulate. So this is another equipment and the ergonomic station workstation. This is not a proper ergonomic workstation. How to design proper ergonomic workstation? So those things also a part of industrial hygienist responsibility.